Hello, I welcome you all to a discussion on the topic civil religion. Let me begin by throwing some light on the concept of what civil religion is. Well, civil religion as a concept originated in French political thought and was popularized in 1950 by Robert Billah. Even tough as a concept, it was known much earlier. It garnered popularity after its use by Robert Billah in the year 1950. What does civil religion mean? Civil religion means the inherent religious values of a nation that is expressed through public rituals, symbols, and ceremonies on sacred days and at sacred places. It means the celebration of a particular event by the whole nation, irrespective of caste, creed, and color. Now, here, when we talk about symbols, we mean the country's flag or the picture of a national leader or party. The sacred days resembles days of high importance and days when certain events had occurred in the past. These days might be the birthday of a national leaders or his day of demise too. The sacred places include monuments, cemeteries, or places of national interest. We have learned that national identity and religion has had a close association since the past. This is also the same case the United States and the Britain. This identification of the religion and national community has led many sociologists to suggest that secular societies can be seen as organized around characteristic pattern of civil religion. Let us shift our focus from the popularity of the term to its origin. So, when did the term civil religion originate? As a term, civil religion was first mentioned by Rousseau in the Social Contract. According to Rousseau, he defined civil religion as a group of religious beliefs that he believed to be universal and which he believed governments had a right to uphold and maintain. For Rousseau, these beliefs could be a belief in a deity, belief in an afterlife in which virtue is rewarded and vice punished, and belief in religious tolerance. He was of the view that the doctrine of civil religion should be few and simple. These doctrines should be stated very precisely without any interpretations or commentaries. Further, Rousseau also believed that individuals' religious opinions should be beyond the reach of governments. The opinions and views one has of any religion, his own or others, should not be influenced by any sort of government. According to him, civil religion was to be constructed and imposed from the top down as an artificial source of civic virtue. Emile Durkheim has comparatively analyzed civil religion. He stressed that the public schools are critical in implementing civil religion, even though he hardly used the term. He was very much interested in the concept of civil religion. It was Rousseau who coined the term in the Social Contract in 1762 to describe what he thought of as the moral and spiritual foundation that is essential for any modern society. For Rousseau, civil religion was a kind of social cement. This social cement helped in the unification of the state by providing it with an authority that was sacred. According to him, there are some simple dogmas of the civil religion. He said that the civil religion consisted of some important features. Firstly, a deity, an afterlife, the reward of virtue, and the punishment of vice. Emilio Gentile, an Italian historian, said that there are two types of religions of politics. The first one is a civil religion, and the second one a political religion. So now, let us throw some light on what civil religion is in the sociology of religion. Well, we know that civil religion is one of the very important concepts in the sociology of religion. By civil religion, in the sociology of religion, we mean the folk religion of a nation or a political culture. We are talking about the religion or culture that is followed by the whole nation despite various differences. Well, we all see that in its social and political status, civil religion lies a little above the folk religion, as it includes all the members of the society irrespective of their creed, caste and color. The differences do not act as an obstacle for celebrating the civil religion or following it. Civil religion takes within it the members of the whole nation and is practiced by the leaders of that particular society. In most of the cases, civil religion is usually practiced by political leaders who are common men and whose leadership is not specifically spiritual and not necessarily relating to supernatural powers, but always linking God to politics. So, what are the activities that generally come under civil religion? Are these activities similar to those of our own religions? Well, there are various activities that come under civil religion. These activities are the inclusion of God in political speeches and public monuments, special mention of scripts and lines in political speeches and announcements from religious texts, the veneration of past political leaders, the use of the lives of these leaders to teach moral ideals, the veneration of veterans and causalities of a nation's wars, religious gatherings called by political leaders, the use of religious symbols on public buildings, the use of public buildings for worship, founding myths and other national myths and similar religious or quasi-religious practices. So, how do we say that civil religion is actually religious? Well, we can say that civil religion is religious in the sense in which Emile Durkheim, eminent French sociologist, has defined religion. Emile Durkheim viewed religion as a unified system of beliefs and practices related to sacred things, that is to say, things that are set apart, and forbidden beliefs and practices which unite into one single moral community called a church or those who adhere to them. Basically, he felt that the beliefs and practices united all together is religion. He was also of the view that cities and nations are just as susceptible to the nomenclature, that is, naming of the sacred, as are the social bodies called church. He gives the example of France during the French Revolution at the end of the 18th century. According to Carlton Hayes in Essays on Nationalism in 1926, he says that if we study carefully our human history, the mainspring of frequency and the force of human movements have been of religious emotion. According to him, it is this religious emotion that has brought about nationalism. He also wrote that human history reveals that human beings have always been differentiated by what is called a religious sense. It is the religious nature of human beings that differentiates us from animals. Well, the term civil religion is also sometimes used to refer to ritual expressions of patriotism of a kind practiced in all countries, not always taking religion in a conventional sense. Some examples that reflect this concept, like the singing of national anthem at events and gatherings, hoisting of flags, holidays to remember important events in history or show respect to important personalities, mythological tales of founding fathers, and even death of soldiers and political leaders. It is in this context of the sense of religion that feeling of patriotism or nationalism, of belonging to a distinct socio-political group, that we have to understand the concept of civil religion. Nisbet says that civil religion has been a highly visible aspect of the modern national state. In the West, civil religion is the religion of an advanced modern society with higher technology. Now, let us all learn a little about the relationship between the sociological and political concept of civil religion. Well, we see that the sociological and political concept of civil religion substantially overlaps each other. We can see that the church and the state are constitutionally joined in the Britain. There is a strong relation between the church and the state. For example, we can see that the coronation of the monarch is a huge religious rite celebrated by the Archbishop of Canterbury. If we take the case of France, we can see secular ceremonies are separated from religious observances to a greater degree than in most countries. Let us talk about the United States of America. In USA, a president being inaugurated is told by the Constitution to choose between saying, "I do solemnly swear," and saying, "I do solemnly affirm," wherein after the first choice one has to mention, "So help me God." After saying that line, even though it's not a constitutional compulsion, and in the latter case, no mention of God is required. So if one swears, God has to be mentioned, but if he or she affirms, there is no compulsion to mention God. Now let us discuss the case of the United States of America. It is a known fact that the most distinct form of civil religion is found in America. In the United States of America, civil religion is used to describe the relationship between religion and national identity. If we understand the basic theory, it says that an informal civil religion binds the American people to God. What brings the Americans closer to God is the civil religion. This civil religion brings about unity and solidarity similar to that relating with more traditional faiths, which diffuses American thought and culture with a sense of divine favor with respect to its inherent value tied to American political and social institutions and mores. Well, if you see, according to the theology of this faith, it is understood that God has chosen the American people for a very special mission in the world, having created the nation of America through divine guardianship during colonization and the American Revolution. It also believes that God had tested their strength of mind to endure adversity with courage during the Civil War. Hence, according to the tenets of civil religion, it is understood that God will ensure the spread of American values throughout the world. American values are supposed to be spread far and wide among every nation. Now, let us come back to civil religion as a concept. As a concept, civil religion goes back to the 19th century, to the time of Rousseau and his social contract, but in current form, the theory was developed by sociologist Robert Billa in 1967 in an article, Civil Religion in America. Robert Neely Billa is an American sociologist born in 23rd February 1927 at Oklahoma, USA. He was one of the most influential sociologists and served for 30 years as a professor of sociology at the University of California in Berkeley. The concept of civil religion soon became the major focus at religious sociology conferences, and numerous articles and books were written on the subject. The debate reached its height with the celebration of the American Bicentennial in 1976. Robert Billa is of the view that Americans hold a common civil religion with certain fundamental beliefs, values, holidays, and rituals parallel to or independent of their chosen religion. This civil religion may be alongside their own personal religion or may also not be related to their own religious beliefs. Billa sees the United States having been united by a religious belief in the sacred character of America and a loyalty to American nation. Here, a special mention may be given that God is also seen as being an American. Well, if see, the civil religion of America is not just religious nationalism. What it does is it emphasizes on the importance of freedom, democracy, and honesty in public affairs. It ensures that it remains loyal to one's own country, enjoys one's own rights and democracy in every sense. If you look into the positive side, it has given the nation a vision of what it may strive to achieve and has contributed to the realization of significant social goals. However, sometimes it has also been used as a propaganda tool for manipulating public opinion for or against a certain policy or group. Hence, we can understand civil religion as a phenomenon that is the result of the partial secularization of major themes in American religious history. The roots of this concept lies in the Puritan conception of the Redeemer Nation, which was based on the theology of election and claimed that New England and later American society would carry out biblical prophecy and set an example of what is godly humanity. At the time of the Revolutionary War, some clergy built upon this idea in their sermons by claiming that patriot forces and political leaders alike endeavored to bring about a divinely ordained republic. These religious themes increasingly appeared in political forums, particularly in religious pronouncements of presidents and governors. Public rituals, such as those associated with Memorial Day and Independence Day, and popular hymns and patriotic songs. Alongside civil religion, politically immersed in the post-millennial rhetoric of the 19th century evangelical movements and social reform efforts. Well, however, we cannot ignore the importance of civil religion in shaping perceptions of the Civil War. Let me take, for example, Abraham Lincoln's second inaugural address of 4th March 1865 shows both the strengths and weaknesses of the civil faith. We see that Lincoln's speech was quite different than that of other speakers of that time. Lincoln did not simply assume that God is within union, but interpreted the war itself as a punishment on both sides for their part in the slave system. If you look at other instances, partisans in the war used religious evidence to support their views. Confederates and Unionists made use of biblical passages to support their views regarding slavery, war, and the condition of the polity. Now, let us come to civil religion in Britain. Well, like the America, there is also a close association between national identity and religion in Britain. In Britain, organizations maintain a role for themselves by involving themselves in civic rituals. In Britain, the Church of England remains the nationalized established church. It is involved in important occasions of the parliament. We see that it is also involved in the celebration and commemoration of national values and events. The royal family is associated in most of the national celebrations and events and civic rituals. Well, there are a number of rituals that are released to the royal family itself. The coronation, the celebrations of the Queen's birthday, the Christmas speech, the trooping of the colour, the state opening of the Parliament, Remembrance Day, and so on. Well, this view of religion and ritual in British society was early seen in the article on the coronation of Queen Elizabeth II in 1953. It was seen that during the coronation, a national community could be affirmed. It was also understood that the basic moral values of the society was reinforced. The coronation of 1953 was the first major televised event where a large audience could be a part of the same civic ritual. So, we see that civil religion is an important aspect of Britain, and there is a close tie between civic rituals, parliament, and monarchy. Now, let us come to our very own nation, India. Well, civil religion is also present in India. Hence, India is no exception to the concept of civil religion. civil religion in India is said to be the religious or quasi-religious regard for certain civic values and traditions found recurrently in the history of the political states. This regard for the civic values and traditions of the political state is expressed through special festivals, rituals, creeds and practices which honor great personages and events of the past. In India, civil religion is celebrated in a semi-religious fervor. Well, we see that all the citizens of India, despite the cultural diversity, celebrate certain days and practice certain rites to mark the significance of that particular day. We Indians celebrate historical importance in unity and by everyone despite differences in caste, color and creed. The sentiments like unity, solidarity and togetherness are enhanced and reflected through this celebration of civil religions. Let us take some examples of celebration of civil religion in India. In India, on every 15th of August, the Prime Minister unfurls the Indian national flag or the Tiranga in the Red Fort at New Delhi. Similarly, a Republic Day parade is held every year on the 26th of January to mark the Indian Republic Day. This celebration is participated by everyone, each citizen of India, whether one is Hindu, Muslim, Buddhist, Christian or Sikh. Such celebrations bring together the citizens of India and indicating the presence of religion that has everyone bound together despite having one's own faith in the existence of a God that is different to theirs. It is clearly understood that civil religion serves to increase the feeling of national pride and political identity. It truly indicates unity in diversity. There are also other days like Gandhi Jayanti and Netaji's birthday that indicates our civil religion in India. It reminds them of the sacrifice made by our leaders like Mahatma Gandhi, Jawaharlal Nehru, Bal Gangadhar Tilak, Bhagat Singh, Chandrasekhar Azad and several others who fought for our independence. There are days like Shahid Divas where we commemorate the sacrifice of our soldiers at war who died while saving the country. This kind of semi-religious fervor in celebrating political events and birthdays of great persons is found in all societies at all times. Likewise, we find the same in the Indian society. Whether it is parades, flag hoisting, national holidays or events, civil rituals and gestures that indicate celebration of civil religion is found in plenty in India. It is no doubt that civil religion has helped in maintaining national unity and solidarity. As we have come to the end of this discussion, we all have seen that civil religion is found in almost all societies, whether it is America, Britain or India. Civil religion tends to bind all the members of the society together, despite the differences in caste, creed and color. It gives one a sense of equality and togetherness. It builds a sense of unity and solidarity. It also helps in promoting nationalism and patriotism in every way. It instills a national identity through various civic rituals. The practice of civil religions and the rituals helps in growth of unity and common national identity. we can see that civic religion has a lot of political and social inclination. However, we should not overemphasize the sensual character of it. We should understand that for many people, participation in public ceremonies and rituals reflect the pragmatic acceptance of them rather than any type of normative commitment. Well, in some cases, people might not also be fully committed to the moral authority of the political leader. However, they may practice the civil rituals and participate in the ceremonies as a custom or part of their daily lives. This may reflect that people may not want to oppose public opinion or deviate from it, and it might be the only reason for their adhering to the civic rituals. Their participation could also be for personal benefits or forced by political authorities. People may participate in the civil rituals just for the sake of it or for their own self-interests, or also maybe out of compulsions from political authorities. With this, we come to the end of our topic on civil religion. Thank you for being a part of this lecture.